Welcome to Keeping It Real with Robin Ning. Robert.
Yes.
It always feels good kapag ka nag-open ang ating show with a good testimony from one of our clients.
That's true. And that segment is called Home Run.
Yes.
Yeah. And we're very excited to present a story about Jocelyn. We've helped their family many, many times.
And just lately po, because of the pandemic, nadagdagan ng almost 100,000 ang kanilang mortgage. And nangailangan ulit sila ng tulong. Kaya, we're here to help. Panoorin po natin kung ano ang nangyari kayla Jocelyn.
Na nagkaproblema ang mag-asawang Jocelyn at Leo sa kanilang bahay sa Daly City. Underwater ang property at hindi na kayang bayanan ng mag-asawa ang mortgage. Bukod dito, nalaman nila na may balloon mortgage pala sila, kaya agad silang humingi ng saklolo kina Robin Ning.
Sabi ko, tawagan ko nga sila kung anong advice nila sa akin. Sabi nila, i-short sell na lang yung bahay. Kasi at that time, yun ano ng bahay, down. So hindi ko maibenta ng gusto kong price.
Short sale ang naging tanging solusyon. Nangailangan silang mangupahan muna para makaipon ng sapat na pondo para makabili ng bahay sa mas affordable na lugar. And this time, may katwang siya sa mga gastusin.
So nakabili kami sa Pittsburgh. Noon kami nakabili ng bahay namin sa tulong din nilang dalawa. So, kasama ko nga yung anak ko, si Jenilyn. Anim nga kami nakatira doon, yung anak ko, yung asawa niya, yung dalawang apo ko, saka kaming mag-asawa. So, hati kami ng anak ko sa lahat-lahat ng mga ano namin sa bahay, hati kami dalawa. Parang nagtutulungan talaga kaming dalawa.
Nabuhay ng matiwasay ang pamilya ng ilang taon. Hanggang dumating ang pandemya na nagdulot ng malaking problema kina Jocelyn at Leo.
A year na walang trabaho. Kahit na may binibigay sa amin na support ng government, still not enough.
Isang taong hindi nakabayad ang mortgage sina Jocelyn at Leo. Hindi lang nadagdagan ang kanilang mortgage debt, pati mga credit cards na max out pa.
Sa 1 year namin hindi pagbayad, about 38,000. Plus yung second loan namin na about 52,000. So worried na ako. Para paano natin mababayaran yung mga utang na yun? So I call na naman si Rob Inning na humingi na naman ako ng advice kung anong dapat kong gawin.
Payini na Robin Ning magpa-refinance dahil may sapat na equity na ang bahay. Pero dahil semi-retired na si Mister, kinailangan nila ulit ang suporta ni Jenilyn.
Ay, sinama ko yung anak ko sa loan kasi siya nga ang mayroong magandang income para at least ma-approve kami sa pag-re-refi namin. So nilagay ko yung anak ko sa titulo ng bahay kasi nga pag tanda namin, ipapamana ko naman sa kanya yon.
So I remember, Rob, when Jocelyn called us again asking me kung meron daw bang sense to refinance the property gayong mataas ang interest rate. And obviously, what we always do, right? We run the numbers, we calculate all the debt, all the payments, including cars on their situation. And if they were to refi, get that high interest rate, what would be the payment compared dun sa kanilang binabayaran on a monthly basis? Their monthly payment by refinancing is much lower than what they are currently paying.
Absolutely. And you know, a lot of people, they hold off refining and they're in the same position as Jocelyn. And they just try to muscle their way through and eventually give up, right? But there are times to refinance with high rates. And this is a good case with Jocelyn. Because the overall payments for all their other unsecured debt and cars is way down compared to, you know, the lower rate plus all the debt. So in this particular example, I highly recommend refinancing at the high rate.
Right. And the fact na merong equity at that time, yung kanilang property when they came to us, they even got some money for reserve you know, para alam nila na there will be a storm coming and they wanted to be prepared. And so I think that that's a great move na ngayon, let's say halimbawa, magtuloy-tuloy pong bumagsak ang real estate market, they are already set. They lower their payment, they have some cash reserve, and you know, they're still living together. Rob, siguro marami sa mga viewers natin ang nagtataka bakit natin pinayuhan si Jocelyn na idagdag yung anak niya doon sa title.
You know, I do not like for parents to put kids on title unless there's a good reason. And you know, Neem, because they're near retirement and the amount of money or the loan that they needed, they brought in their daughter, Jenilyn, right, who has a good job. And she was able to help assist in getting the loan so that they could accomplish this.
Right. And the fact, Rob, na, you know, they are helping each other out on every aspect ng expenses sa bahay, you know, and utilities, groceries, mortgages. I really like this story dahil we always hear some stories na kids will just live with parents and
Not help.
Not paying anything.
Not go on the loan, just live.
Right. And so I think, you know, they did a great job in setting up the stage with the kids na, okay, we're going to retire pretty soon here, and so I want you to take over, right? Mm-hmm. Since you are paying, helping us on the mortgages and all the expenses in the house, then why not? Since since talaga naman pong pinlano ng mag-asawa na, you know, that house is for the daughter.
Yeah, and you know, we talk a lot about kids going on title with their parents, right? And so they can help with a loan and not necessarily go on title.
That's right. Right.
And they could have done that in this case.
Right.
But, you know, Jocelyn and Leo, you know, they chose to put Jenilyn on because she helps so much, right?
Right.
And it is for her future. So, you know, Ning, we usually don't advise for kids to go on title for the reason that, you know, parents lose their ability to refinance or they lose the ability to get cash or they lose the ability to sell. But in this particular case, and Jenilyn's so involved with all that they do, you know, it worked out.
Yeah, I mean, it just makes sense, right? Pero kung let's say po sabihin natin, well, okay, I have kids and I want my kids to be on title. Well, we suggest na magkaroon tayo ng trust instead or ng will, right? That way, especially if we have more than one kids, right? That way, malinaw na pag, when you know, at our passing, we know exactly where our assets would go.
You know, we've been talking a lot about, you know, the economy and what's going on and stuff, you know, the downward trend in home values and stuff. I think they're in a great position to kind of weather through what might come, right? Because number one, right, they consolidated all their debt into one payment.
Right.
And it's much lower than what they had.
Right.
Number two, they've kind of consolidated with their kids and they're all contributing. So it makes it easier for each party to survive the downturn, right? And number three, it really sets up for a nice retirement for Jocelyn and Leo.
Right. So we are so proud of the Casilla family dahil, you know, they hit the home run.
Maraming salamat. Naiyak. Every time na meron akong problema sa bahay, tinatawagan ko sila. Malaking tulong sila sa amin. Kasi nga, mula since then, from noong nandito kami sa Delhi City hanggang nakalipat kami sa bahay namin ngayon, sila ang tumutulong sa amin. Kaya, ang laki ng pasasalamat ko sa kanilang dalawa. Kaya, sana nga, mabigyan pa sila ng mahabang buhay para marami silang natutulungan, kagaya ko.
Marami po ang nagtatanong kung pwedeng i-explain ko further when I say na ang minamana ng mga heirs natin sa reverse mortgage is just equity, hindi debt. So, this is my opportunity po na maipaliwanag ito sa inyo. So, let's give a number para po mas madali nating maintindihan. Kung let's say ang debt ng mag-asawa o ng ating parents is $500,000 and then nagkaroon ng equity nung mawala sila yung at the passing ng borrower, ang naging value ng bahay is $800,000. So that means meron pong $300,000 na equity na yung ating heirs ay mamanahin. So what they need to do is they need to get their own loan para mabayaran ng heirs natin yung 500,000 na balance, and they can keep the house na merong $300,000 equity. Or they can sell it and get the equity. So let's say po, nagkabaliktad at the passing ng ating parents, ang utang is 500,000 pero ang naging value is 300,000. Huwag po kayong mawala ng pag-asa. Dito po papasok yung sinasabi natin na ang ating mga heirs, ang mamanahin lang is equity, not debt. Dahil ang atin pong mga heirs, ang kailangan lang nilang gawin is kumuha sila ng 95% loan ng kung ano yung current market value at that time. So on our example, kung 500 yung pong naiwang debt ng ating parents, at ang value at that time is 300,000, so yun pong ating mga heirs, they only need $285,000 worth of loan para makip yung property. So, pagka po they decide to keep the home, ibig sabihin, meron na kaagad silang $15,000 na equity. That's why, sa reverse mortgage, ang minamana lang po ng ating heirs is equity, not debt. And that's why we kept telling and trying to explain everybody yung power ng reverse mortgage. Kasi po, hindi ito kayang gawin ng any other loan but reverse mortgage. And this is a good opportunity po kung meron tayong malaking equity sa property and we are on a retirement age, then maybe it's a good choice para po ma-secure natin lalo ang ating, not just our housing natin while we are still here as parents, yung pong ating mga anak, ma-secure din natin yung kanilang mana. So, i-review po natin ulit ang basics ng reverse mortgage. Kung kayo po ay 62 and older at yung inyong property that you want to keep for the rest of your life, meron po kayong enough equity sa property, you can do reverse mortgage and stay there for the rest of your life. Hindi tayo i-require to pay our mortgages. Pero yung pong iba ang ginagawa, they continue to pay their mortgage, which is fine. Kung gusto nyo pong ipagpatuloy yung pagbabayad ng principal and interest, you can. O gusto nyo interest only lang on some months, you can. Or if you want to have a vacation and don't want to worry about the mortgage payment, you can. Hindi po kayo mapo-foreclose. Ang only reason po na mapo-foreclosean tayo is kung hindi tayo magbabayad ng ating property taxes and insurance on a timely manner, at saka kung hindi po natin i-upkeep ang property. Pero obviously, kung tayong parents, naka-reverse mortgage tayo, we can bring in our children with us, live in our property, and actually po, pwede rin nating parentahan yung mga kwarto if you need it. Kasi I heard a lot of stories like that na pinaparentahan nila yung mga kwarto as an additional income. You can do that on reverse mortgage for as long as you are occupying the main property. So, ito lang pong reverse mortgage na to ang talagang we thought solusyon sa mga retirees. And by the way, kapag kapo jumbo loan, just a reminder na they accept 55 years and older. It's so amazing. So it's important na i-take advantage po natin yung ating equity hanggat meron tayo, knowing na alam na natin, naiintindihan natin yung basics ng reverse mortgage. Naku Robert, ang making it story natin ngayon is about Chef Yana. Would you imagine moving all over the country, sinetup niya yung sarili niya na mag-travel siya to every state for 50 weeks just to promote yung Filipino cuisine.
Yeah, that is amazing because, you know, that's a lot of travel. Mm-hmm. And you got to go every week, you're going to a new state. You're developing a plan. You're doing a pop-up.
Right.
And a pop-up is you are like in a street fair or something. Mm-hmm. And you're delivering delicious Filipino food to educate people.
Yeah.
Right?
I'm so proud of her, Robert. I mean, yung kanyang commitment and dedication para ipakita at ipaalam sa buong mundo o sa buong Amerika, yeah, ang lasa ng Filipino cuisine. It's just amazing with all the efforts that, mm-hmm, she's doing.
Yeah, and she lives in Oakland, which is right near us, right? Mm-hmm. So we're excited to share her story.
Panoorin po natin si Chef Yana.
Hi, I'm Yana Gilbuena Babu, and I am the founder and chef of Salo Series, which is a Kamayan Filipino pop-up dinner that travels globally. My first memory of being useful in the kitchen was actually when I was around 4 or 5. My Lola was very annoyed with me because I was like, come play. And she was like, you have way too much energy. I'm just gonna put you in the kitchen and help with like preparing the food. So ever since then, like I've always spent like a good chunk of my time in the kitchen. I learned how to wield a knife at like 4. When I first immigrated to the US, I realized how expensive things were. You know, going out to dinner or like having, you know, merienda with friends, like everything adds up. And after the first 3 months of like, why am I so broke? You know, I was like, I think I need to cook at home. And so I just started cooking because I knew how to, but it's not because like, oh, I want to find my way in the culinary world. It was more of a survival instinct. And I really thought that cooking was, you know, a skill that everyone possessed. I didn't think that that was like, you know, something magical or like a talent. So cooking became more of a vocation for me when I moved to New York. And that's when I got introduced into the world of pop-up dining. Living in New York and realizing that this is the melting pot of cultures, you know, and this is like the multicultural hub of America, yet Filipino food was not prevalent. And that made me so confused because I was like, there are so many Filipinos in New York. I see them all the time. And why is there not enough representation of our cuisine? And that made me want to like start doing something. Not just like, oh, I want to have a restaurant, but I want to educate people what Filipino food is. Because most of the time, when you talk to people and they're like, oh, you're Filipino, do you want to bring adobo, lumpia, pancit? And I'm just like, yeah, I can make those, but there's so many other dishes that we could always offer to people. So I was about 3/4 of a year in doing pop-ups, because at the time I still had a real job, you know? So I was doing my pop-ups on a quarterly basis. And there has just been an ongoing, enormous amount of support. And when I got laid off from my job, I was at a crossroads, really. At that time, I had a mentor. His name was Noel. And I was so distraught, obviously, like losing your job in New York, and I was so stressed. I was like, oh my God, how am I gonna make rent, you know? And we sat down and he was like, you know, there's 52 weeks in a year and there are 50 states.
So back in 2014, I launched the Salo Project, which is different from Salo Series, where my goal was to do a Kamayan pop-up in 50 states in 50 weeks, featuring regional Filipino cuisine with local city or state ingredients.
I really did do 50 states in 50 weeks, plus Washington, D.C. So how I designed the tour was, we're gonna be on a budget. We're gonna take the train, the bus, hitchhike, whatever it is that we need to do, and just trying to really connect with people on the most basic level of like, I'm trying to give you something, and I'm trying to share my identity and culture with you. I hope you're receptive with that. There were times where I sold out dinners, and it was amazing. There were times where everything just fell into place, and there were times where 2 people showed up, you know? It wasn't just about bringing the gospel of Filipino food to all the 50 states. It was about making people realize that it's okay to eat with their hands. And the act of eating with their hands actually gives us a direct connection with our food, with each other, because it's a sensual activity. Like, dining is a sensual activity. And why should we have a middleman for dining when we can taste it, we can smell it, We can hear it, but the touch factor makes it whole as a dining experience. The fact that people are actually willing to eat with their hands, people in America. Cooking-wise, the biggest revelations were there's always an Asian market somewhere. It doesn't necessarily have to be Filipino. And little things where I was able to find malunggay, for example, in Wisconsin. And I was like, well, that's very bizarre, finding malunggay in Wisconsin, you know? Another one of them was there's always a Filipino somewhere. Not necessarily working in food, but like in different industries that I wouldn't have thought that, or in different states and cities that I never thought I would find a Filipino. You know, like Bismarck, North Dakota. Like, who knew? Finishing all 51 cities in 50 weeks, I think I was in shock because I've been running on pure adrenaline this entire time. Every dinner, like, I barely had enough time to really stay there, connect with people, and I had to, like, go, go, go because I was on my own self-mandated schedule. If I did 50 states, what's stopping me from doing a Canadian tour, a South American tour, a Europe tour? It made me feel like I can accomplish anything. I wrote a book called No Forks Given, and it was about the 50-state tour and also recipes that I formulated or acquired during my pop-up tour. The fact that people now do their own Kamayan dinners, whether it's at home or there are more restaurants offering it or like more pop-ups offering Kamayan, you know, I think I did my part. I think where I am now is I'm trying to pivot more to like mentorship and helping folks, you know, who are starting because I feel I'm at a stage in my life where I want to give back to community and I want to help others who are just starting out because when I was starting, there was not really a lot of help or support from the Filipino community. And I want to change that. I want to change that narrative. Like, no, this is not crab mentality. This is how we progress. This is how we rise up. We rise up together. One thing that I want to share is I'm organizing a Filipino food and wine festival here in October. So it's a 3-day festival celebrating the history of Filipinos in California within the food and wine industry and agriculture because October is Filipino American History Month. So the Filipino food and wine festival is going to be called Lamon, and Lamon means to devour. It is October 6, 7, and 8. So we will be releasing tickets starting September of 2023, and you just have to follow Salo Series on Instagram to get more information.
Ning, this has been a fun show. You know, we had a great making it, right? Mm-hmm. You did your thing,
yes,
right? And we had a great home run to kick off the show.
Actually, Robert, yung 30 minutes is really not enough, yeah, right? Kaya nga po ginagawa namin yung live experience through Facebook. So, kung kayo po ay magpa-follow and magsa-subscribe sa aming Facebook and YouTube, you can join ang amin pong live experience na ginaganap once a month. So kung ipo-follow nyo po, makikita nyo doon kung kailan ang next live experience. I'm so excited because I think people needs to know more about what's going on around, yeah, us at kung ano yung mga ideas. We can change views on how we see things.
Absolutely. And, you know, we like to share the culture, right? Mm-hmm. The Filipino culture. And that's why I like the Making Its and the Phil-Ams, right? And so I look forward to those live events.
Me too.
You know, if you have any questions about tonight's episode, give us a call at 888-860-9530, or you can visit us online.
Or go to our website po and schedule yourself for a free consultation with either Robert or Ning, or visit our Facebook page, Keeping It Real with Rob and Ning.
And also, don't forget to join us again next week for another episode of Keeping It Real with Rob and Ning. Until then, bye.
For 15 years now, Rob and Ning have been helping people across the USA with their home, money, and retirement problems. The results can be life-changing. It's all about setting a goal, strategizing a plan, and doing it right. They're ready, they're reliable, they're real, and they can help in all 50 states. Call 888-860-9530 or visit their website.
Kapag na-miss mo, pwedeng balikan. Pwedeng panoorin ang videos at playlists na gusto mo. Like, comment, at ishare ang videos kasama ng lumalaki nating pamilya sa online world. Kahit kailan, kahit saan pa. Forever tayong kapamilya. Kapamilya Online Live.